Hello students, welcome to the chapter of quadratic equations. Let us revise quadratic equations. Before we go into the theoretical aspect of quadratic equations, let us first see how this chapter is impacting our JE Main papers. So if you look at the papers of JE Main which were conducted in January 2020, means this year. So if you look at the analysis of January 2020, there were a total of 6 papers and a total of 7 questions were asked. If you look at the papers conducted in April 2019, then there were a total of 8 papers and there were 8 questions. So basically one question per paper averaging. Then if you look at January 2019 JE Main papers, so there were again 8 papers and 6 questions in total from quadratic equations were there. So if you look at this data, we can understand that one question per paper is the average. So it is highly likely that the paper which you attempt in the next, whenever it is going to be conducted, one question from quadratic equation will definitely come. Now, quadratic equations is a fairly simple topic. There are not many theoretical points. It's quite simple. Let us start revision of quadratic. So the first thing in quadratic which we have to learn is what is called as definition of quadratic. Let us see what is the definition of quadratic. So the definition of quadratic is any equation of the form ax square plus bx plus c equal to 0, where a is not equal to 0. Obviously, if a is 0, then it becomes a linear, right? So this, any equation of this form is called as a quadratic equation. Now, as far as IIT JEE syllabus is concerned, we would be considering a, b, c as real numbers only. Means we would not be, taking imaginary coefficients in quadratic. So by the way, these A, B, C are called as coefficients, right? You know that. After definition, the next thing which we want to learn, we want to understand in quadratic is what is called as root of a quadratic. So what is root of a quadratic equation? So see, root of a quadratic equation is that value of x which satisfies the quadratic equation. So if, let us say, A alpha square plus B alpha plus C is 0, then we would say that alpha is a root of quadratic. So root is a value which basically satisfies the equation. Okay. Next, after this comes nature of roots. So let's talk about that. So nature of roots. So nature of roots. So in nature of roots, the value of roots is, so if you solve a quadratic, let us say this quadratic x square plus bx plus c equal to 0. So if you solve it, the value of x will be minus b plus minus root over b square minus 4ac upon 2a. So here this b square minus 4ac is called as discriminant, right? Oh wait, I think you can't see. Let me just drag it a little down. Yeah. So the value of x, which we, after solving this quadratic equation, we get the value of x like this. So this we get by completing perfect square. In this value of root, this b square minus 4ac, it is called as discriminant of quadratic. So this is a quantity of use, we can predict the nature of roots based on the value of D. So let us just quickly do this. If D is greater than 0, that means roots are real and different or distinct. If D is equal to 0, then we say that the roots are real and equal. Now, when the roots are real and equal, one question comes to our mind is, what are they equal to? So see, here we have just written the roots, so we can use that only. So if roots are real and equal, then we say D is 0. Suppose D is 0, then this quantity which I have shaded here, it will vanish. So if this goes away, what is left? What is left is minus B upon 2A. So we can say, when the roots are real and equal, they are equal to minus B upon 2A. So this is the value of equal roots. Right. Third point, if D becomes negative. So if D becomes negative, then we say that the quadratic has imaginary roots. So whenever the roots are imaginary, they are also all obviously conjugate. So we should extend this and say that if D is negative, then the roots are imaginary and conjugate. What is the meaning of imaginary and conjugate? What we mean to say is this. If 2 plus 3i is an imaginary root of a quadratic, then 2 minus 3i will be the other root. Now 2 minus 3i is basically conjugate of 2 plus 3i, right? So how can we say this? This is quite simple. Look at this quantity b square minus 4ac over here. So you can see this is inside the square root. If this quantity becomes negative, b square minus 4ac, if it becomes negative, this one, then I will come because of square root of minus 1. And plus minus is already there, so you can quickly understand that if 2 plus 3i is one root, then 2 minus 3i has got to be the other root. One more point we can add here that we can just summarize this in one more sentence, that we can say that imaginary roots of a quadratic equation occur in conjugate pairs, right? So conjugate pair means one root is conjugate of the other. Now there is one more point like this here. If A, B, C, that is the coefficients of quadratic, are rational, belongs to Q. Q means set of rational numbers. Are rational numbers, then irrational roots will also be in certain kind of pairs, same kind of pairs, in the sense that if 2 plus root 3 is one root, then 2 minus root 3 will definitely be the other root. But there is a condition. What is the condition? That the coefficients should be rational. Let us look at an example to understand this more nicely, this point. See, let me give you a quadratic, a sample quadratic. So look at this quadratic, x square minus 2 plus root 3 into x plus 2 root 3 equal to 0. Now this quadratic is fairly simple, and I am sure that you will be able to solve and find out that the roots of this quadratic are 2 and root 3. Correct. Now 2 and root 3 are not conjugates, right? In the sense which we were talking about. So why it is happening that we are getting two roots which are not like 2 plus root 3 and 2 minus root 3 style? So why this happened is because here you see the coefficients, they are not rational. So rational coefficients is very, very important. Okay. Now let's move on to the next section. After nature of fruits, after understanding nature of fruits, the next thing we learn is what is called as factor theorem of a quadratic. So let us go and learn factor theorem. Okay, factor theorem. So what is factor theorem? What is it trying to tell us? See, if factor theorem is basically telling us how to factorize a quadratic. So it says that if alpha and beta are roots of a quadratic, then x minus alpha and x minus beta are factors of same quadratic. Factors means it will be divisible, right? So let us let me give you a quick example. So this is a very famous problem. It's like this, that if alpha beta are roots of, let us say, a quadratic x minus gamma into x minus delta minus k equal to 0, then prove that gamma and delta are roots of quadratic x minus alpha x minus beta plus k equal to 0. Now I'm sure you must have done this question already. You might have done, or you might know this question, how to do this question. Still let's just do this question. So by using factor theorem, there are other ways to obviously do this question, but let's do by using factor theorem. So what have we learned in factor theorem is, suppose you have a quadratic. So here we have one quadratic equation, and we know the roots of this quadratic equation. So the roots of this quadratic equation are alpha and beta. So if alpha and beta are the roots of this quadratic, then x minus alpha and x minus beta are the factors of this quadratic. So definitely this quadratic can be factorized in this way. Now what you should do is just take this k to this side. So you will get x minus gamma into x minus delta equal to k plus x minus alpha into x minus beta. Now see, magically this becomes now the quadratic, and these becomes now the factors. Let me write factors here also. So as you saw, for this quadratic these were the factors. Now for this quadratic these are the factors. So if these values are the factors of the quadratic on the right hand side, then gamma and delta must be roots of the quadratic on the right hand side, hence root. So factor theorem is quite a nice theorem, and it is used in many other places also. After understanding factor theorem, let us go and learn relation between roots and coefficients. So let us go ahead and do this. Relation between roots and coefficients. So let us take a quadratic equation. Let us take ax square plus bx plus c equal to 0. So in this quadratic equation, a, b and c, these are what we call as coefficients. And let us say alpha and beta are roots of this quadratic. So what is the relation between alpha, beta and abc? That is the question. So you might already know that alpha plus beta is minus b by a, and alpha into beta is c by a. This is the relation between roots and coefficients. So this can be obviously proved by using the exact value of alpha and beta, but let me show you by using factor theorem. So ax square plus bx plus c is equal to a into x minus alpha into x minus beta, because alpha and beta are the roots, so x minus alpha and x minus beta are the factors. But a we have to adjust, because if you just take x minus alpha and x minus beta, the coefficient of x square will be 1. In the left hand side, the coefficient of x square is a, so we have to match it. Now just compare coefficients. So compare coefficients of x power 1 and x power 0, and you will get the results alpha plus beta and alpha into beta. Right, so I am leaving it up to you to do this. Having understood the relation between roots and coefficients, the next thing in quadratic is symmetric function of roots. So let's do symmetric function of roots. So symmetric function of roots, see, basically symmetric function of roots is any function which is symmetric with respect to alpha and beta. So for example, alpha cube plus beta cube, or alpha by beta plus beta by alpha, or alpha beta square plus alpha square beta, and so on. So the whole idea is that if you suppose interchange alpha and beta, if you interchange alpha and beta, the function should not change, function should remain same. So in that case, we would say, okay, this is symmetric function of roots. Next in quadratic equations is quadratic equation as an identity. So quadratic equation as an identity. So what is the statement here is that if a quadratic equation has more than two roots, then it becomes an identity. That's how it is said. So I will write it like this: if ax square plus bx plus c equal to 0 is true for more than two values of x, then ax square plus bx plus c equal to 0 is true for all values of x. This is what is meant. So this point is basically trying to tell you that a quadratic, if it is really a quadratic, will not become true for more than two values of x. But if it so happens that it becomes true for more than two values of x, then it will become true for every value of x. So basically what he is trying to tell you is, okay, one more point of confusion with students generally is that if a quadratic equation becomes an identity, then all its coefficients become zero, right? So many students are not able to understand this. Let's understand this point a little bit. See, why they are saying it is like this. See, if a quadratic equation does become an identity, now what is an identity? An identity is an expression, is an equation which is true for all values of x, which is like always true. So if a quadratic equation were to become an identity, it must become true for all values of x. It must be true always. So ax square plus bx plus c equal to 0 is always true only when a is 0, b is 0, c is 0. In short, what we are trying to say here is that 0x square plus 0x plus 0 equal to 0 is the only quadratic, which it's not a quadratic, this is the only way in which a quadratic will have more than two roots. So in short, if the coefficients are non-zero, then it will never become true for more than two values of x, right? So let us do one question just to get this point right properly across. So let's take one question. So what I'm taking as the fairly standard problem, but let's just take this. So problem is this, that prove that x minus a into x minus b upon c minus a c minus b c square plus x minus b x minus c upon a minus b a minus c a square plus x minus c x minus a upon b minus c b minus a b square. It is equal to x square for all x belonging to R. This we have to prove. Sorry, you can't see. Let me just drag it a little down. Yes. So we have to prove this. Now one way to prove this is just simplify, which is obviously not the point. I must not have taken this question if that was what I was going to do. So how to do this is like this. So what we will do is we will assume this whole thing as, let us say, p of x. So this entire thing we have assumed as p of x. Now definitely p of x is a quadratic. Now we will observe that p of a is a square. See, if you put a, those terms containing x minus a will become 0, right? So just put and check, p of a is definitely a square. Similarly, p of b is b square and p of c is c square. No, if p of a is a square, p of b is b square and p of c is c square, we cannot say that p of x is x square. No, this is not right. This is not right explanation. So using this data, we will manipulate this in a certain way. Let us do that. Let q of x is equal to p of x minus x square. Just assume. Now find q of a. It will be 0 because p of a is equal to x square, a square. Similarly, find q of b. It will also be 0. And q of c, it will also be 0. Now p of a equal to a square has less use, but q of a equal to 0 has more use, because q of a equal to 0 means a is root of q, correct? Q of b is 0 means b is root of q. Similarly, c is also root of q. Now we have already established that q of x cannot be a cubic because it is equal to px minus x square. Px is not a cubic, it is a quadratic, and x square is definitely not a cubic. So qx is a quadratic, has more than two roots. Let's write three roots only. No, it has three roots. So qx has three roots. So basically what we are trying to say is qx is equal to 0 for three values of x. So what is the conclusion? If qx is equal to 0 for three values of x, then qx is equal to 0 for all values of x. So if qx is equal to 0 for all values of x, then p of x is minus x square is 0 for all values of x, or p of x is equal to x square for all values of x. So this is a problem on factor theorem. This quadratic equations becoming an identity. So let's go to our next section. So next comes sine of quadratic expression. So let us take a quadratic expression, y is equal to ax square plus bx plus c. Now once you bring y into the picture, now this is plottable. Now you can plot the graph because both x and y are there. So let us do a little manipulation here. Take a common, x square plus b by ax plus c by a. So complete the perfect square, x plus b by 2a whole square. To convert this perfect square, we would have to add b square by 4a square. So we will subtract that also. So finally, it is still equal to a into x plus b by 2a whole square plus 4ac minus b square by 4a square. So this is what we have. Let us rearrange this a little bit. So it becomes x plus b by 2a whole square equal to 1 by a into y plus d by 4a. So I have written 4ac minus b square as d. So why we are doing this? See this. Let's add some effect to this. So x plus b by 2a whole square is equal to 1 by a and y plus d by 4a. This is a parabola of form x square equal to 4ay. Please see this. So since it is a parabola, the graph of a quadratic is going to be a parabola, a vertical parabola. And by comparison, we can simply say that the vertex of such a parabola is going to be minus b by 2a comma minus d by 4a. Now this parabola will open upward or downward, it depends upon the value of 1 by a. So if a is positive, then parabola is concave up. And if a is negative, then parabola is concave down. Right. So the effect of a can also be explained in this way, that from here, if you find out d2y by dx square, you would be getting 2a. Now, if f double dash is positive, then the graph is concave up, right? This we study in calculus. And if f double dash is less than 0, then the graph is concave down. It's quite simple. Positive means up, then negative means down. So we can also explain by using double derivative, but when you studied quadratic at that time these concepts were not covered. So now we can at least mix them up. So basically, the graph of a quadratic is a parabola which is vertical, and it will be upward or downward depending upon the sine of a. Let us see a few graphs. So if a is positive, then three kind of graphs are possible, because even if, see, first of all, we have understood that if a is positive, graph is concave up, right? Now the graph is concave up, but what about d? So d may be positive, d may be 0, or d may be negative. Now how do we know the graph will look like this? So see, we will establish it to the vertex. So vertex is minus b by 2a comma minus d by 4a. Again over here, minus b by 2a comma minus d by 4a, and over here minus b by 2a comma minus d by 4a. So it is minus d by 4a which decides. So see, if a is positive and d is also positive, so definitely we can say minus b upon 2a is negative, because not minus b by 2a, minus d by 4a. Let's just change that. minus d by 4a. See, x coordinate of the vertex will just move the graph left and right. It's the y coordinate which matters. So minus d by 4a, d is positive, so minus d is negative. And if y coordinate of the vertex is negative, that means vertex lies below x-axis. If vertex lies below x-axis, then the graph has to cut x-axis at two points. And wherever the graph cuts x-axis, there the roots lie. So graph will cut x-axis if d is positive. So roots will be there if d is positive, correct? Now if d is 0, then obviously minus d by 4a is also 0. So vertex lies on x-axis, this is fairly simple graph. And if a is positive and d is negative, then the value of minus d by 4a will definitely be positive. So the y coordinate of vertex lies above x-axis. Y coordinate of vertex is positive. So we can say vertex lies above x-axis. So we can quickly and clearly draw this graph, and we can conclude that the graph will look like this only. There is no other way the graph can look. Now, let us also consider those three cases when a is negative. So if a is negative, then again three cases are there, that d might be positive, d might be 0, or d might be negative. So if a is negative, d is positive. D is positive means two roots, as you can see. And the way in which we did the previous analysis, you can do the same here. So here alpha and beta are same, and they are both equal to minus b by 2a. And here also we have our vertex minus b by 2a minus d by 4a. Simply by the help of a and d, we can prove that the vertex will lie below x-axis in the third case. So these are the kind of graphs which we get for a quadratic. Let us sum them up. Let us conclude, make some conclusions here. So what can we conclude about the graphs? See, the first conclusion, which is the simplest, is if d is negative, then sine of fx is equal to sine of a. Simple conclusion. Let us just have a look at this quick review. See, if when a was positive, the graph was also positive, it was lying above x-axis. When a became negative, both the cases are for d less than 0. When a was negative, graph was also lying below x-axis, means graph is also negative. So graph is behaving in the same way. Sine of graph is same as sine of a. So we are saying sine of fx equal to sine of a. We can write it like this also, that a into fx is greater than 0 for all x belonging to R. Similarly, if d is equal to 0, then as you can see, it is kind of like same. D is equal to 0 are the middle cases which we drew. So if d is equal to 0, then we can say a into fx is greater than or equal to 0. So why equal to? Because it fx can become equal also. So equality happens at x equal to minus b by 2a. So if d is 0, then if you put minus b by 2a, then the value of the quadratic will also become 0, right? Now if d is positive, then there are cases. Then if d is positive, then the quadratic, let us say f of x, has real and distinct roots. Let us say the roots are alpha and beta. So obviously if d is positive, we can write the quadratic f of x as a into x minus alpha into x minus beta. Now depending upon the sine of a, we can find the sine of the quadratic also, sine of fx also. So this is okay, let's just conclude a little bit. So little more conclusions we can make here. So see this x minus alpha into x minus beta, if you can see this portion, it is positive for all x lying outside the roots. Let's just remove this because it is creating some problem. Or instead of writing this way, let me just write this x outside roots. And this value is negative for all x between roots. Means if you put a value of x which lies between alpha and beta, this portion will become negative. So everything depends upon A. So we can conclude like this, that if D is positive, then A into fx will be positive for all x outside roots. Outside the roots means, suppose roots are alpha and beta, so it should not lie between alpha and beta. And A into f of x is less than 0 for all x between roots. Let me show you a graph also, just to be little clear. So we have a graph over here, like this. Now you can see that this value, this graph of fx lies below x-axis. The portion of graph which lies below x-axis is negative, right? Correct? So we can say fx is negative when x lies between alpha and beta. Then fx is negative. Look at here, when x lies between alpha and beta, in this case the graph lies above x-axis, means the graph is positive, fx is greater than 0. So as you can see, when A is negative, then fx is positive, and when A is positive, then fx is negative. So A and f of x are of opposite sign when x lies between the roots. This is our conclusion. So we are writing it in this way. Over here we have written that A into f of x is less than 0 when or for all x lying between the roots. Okay, this conclusion is actually needed later on also. And A into f of x is greater than 0 if x lies outside the roots. This will be needed for the next section, which is the location of roots. So let us go ahead and do location of roots. So our next section is location of roots. Let's start that. Location of roots basically means that you are trying to fix conditions on the coefficients based on the location of roots. So let's start doing it one by one. So let us put our first condition. So for the sake of definition, we are going to use f of x as ax square plus bx plus c. So first condition is both roots are greater, or let me write it like this, greater than some number k. So if both roots are greater than k, what are the conditions on ABC? So let's write those conditions. See, if both roots are greater than k, let me show you a side graph. Something like this the graph will look like, and k would be somewhere here. Little bigger. We can draw here and remove later. So graph would look something like this. K is over here. So both the roots are greater than k. So the first condition for both roots greater than k is d greater than equal to 0. Why? Because if roots are not real, they cannot become greater than k. So first of all, roots must be real. Second, if both the roots are greater than k, then this line, which is the line of symmetry x equal to minus b by 2a, should also lie beyond k. So we would say minus b by 2a greater than k. But this is not sufficient. So one more condition is there: a into f of k greater than 0. So you might have read this condition. Now you can understand why this condition comes. So if both the roots alpha and beta are greater than k, then definitely k lies outside roots. K is outside roots or not? And what did we just study? That if some x lies outside the roots, then a into f of x is greater than 0. So a into f of k is greater than 0. That means k lies outside the roots, which is good for us. So these three conditions, and you should not forget this AND. What this AND basically means is, now after solving d greater than 0, this condition and this condition and this condition, you have to take intersection. Okay, let's go to next case. Second condition is both roots are less than k. So what should we do if both the roots of a quadratic are less than a number k? So if both the roots of a quadratic are less than a number k, then the conditions would be d greater than or equal to 0 and minus b by 2a less than k and a into f of k greater than 0. So I am leaving this up to you to identify how this comes about. Now let us go to third condition. So third condition in location of roots is, both roots lie in an interval k1 comma k2. So obviously here we have to do union of 1 and 2. So we will say d greater than or equal to 0 and k1 less than minus b by 2a less than k2 and a into f of k1 greater than 0 from here and a into f of k2 also greater than 0, because k1 and k2 both should lie outside the roots. Fourth condition is k lies between the roots. Then what is the condition? So if k lies between the roots, there is only one condition: a into f of k less than 0. Remember, just now we did here, if a into fx is less than 0, then x lies between the roots. So if k wants to lie between the roots, then the condition is a into f of k less than 0. Fifth, interval k1 comma k2 lies between the roots. Then what is the condition? So it's also very simple: a into f of k1 less than 0 and a into f of k2 also less than 0. That's enough. And one more, last, sixth. Exactly one root lies in the interval k1 comma k2. So the condition for this is f of k1 into f of k2 less than 0. This is simply intermediate value theorem, right? So these are the conditions for locations of roots. If roots are located somewhere, then how to identify and do what, how to use that to solve and get answers. Next, after this, in quadratics comes polynomials. So let's do polynomials now. Okay, So, before we going into polynomials, we forgot one topic, condition for common roots. Let's just discuss this. So, suppose we have two quadratic equations, a1x square plus b1x plus c1 equal to 0, and a2x square plus b2x plus c2 equal to 0. And and they have, and both the roots are common, both roots. So if both roots are common, like alpha beta are the roots of first quadratic and alpha beta are the roots of second quadratic, so if both roots are common, then the condition between a1 b1 c1 and a2 b2 c2 is that a1 by a2 b equal to b1 by b2 is equal to c1 by c2. Now generally students assume that if both roots are common, then the quadratics are same and then the coefficients must also be same. So we have already taken one example, you remember, like I told you, 2x square minus 10x plus 12 equal to 0. The roots of this quadratic are 2 and 3. And 3x square minus 15x plus 18 equal to 0. The roots of this quadratic also 2, 3. So see, both the quadratics have same roots. Both roots are common. But are the coefficients same? No. So if both roots are common, the best thing we can say is that the coefficients are proportional. So we should not think that coefficients are same. So we can write that coefficients are proportional, check spellings and all. Now this is the case when both roots are common. If only one root is common, then the condition is c1 a2 minus c2 a1 whole square equal to a1 b2 minus a2 b1 b1 c2 minus b2 c1. So it might feel that I have written it effortlessly, but it is not so effortlessly. There is a method, there is a way of remembering it. So let's talk about the remembering technique. So how to remember the condition for both roots common? So we remember it like this. What you do is you write down all the coefficients of first equation, a1, b1, c1. Also you write down all the coefficients of second equation, a2, b2, c2. After doing this, take the constants c1 and c2 and repeat them like this. Now see, cross multiply like a determinant. So c1 a2 minus c2 a1 whole square is your this term. Then we have a1 b2 minus a2 b1, a1 b2 minus a2 b1, and then we have b1 c2 minus b2 c1. So that's how we can remember this. How to prove it? Proving is quite simplistic, quite proving is not an issue. So okay, let's just see how to do it. So let us say we take this data. And we will use it over here. So there are two quadratics with us. Let us say that their roots are alpha, beta, and alpha, gamma. So the other roots are not same. Only one root is common. So when one root is common, we can put that root. In this way. Now this is two equations and two variables. It might feel that there is only one variable, but you just treat it as two variables. So by solving these equations, we can get alpha square and alpha. That's it. Then after finding alpha square and alpha, eliminate alpha. There will be no more alpha and you will get the condition. Right, so now let us go to polynomials. So polynomials. Right. So polynomial is an equation of this form. So if an is not equal to 0, then n is called as degree of polynomial. Okay, so the first point about polynomials is n degree polynomial has n roots. Means what it is trying to say is a 3 degree polynomial will always have 3 roots, a 5 degree polynomial will always have 5 roots. So an n degree polynomial will always have n roots. Whether they are real or imaginary, repeating, non-repeating, whichever way you want to count it. Right. So this is aside. Now second point is n degree polynomial has n real roots, n roots, not, I'm not saying real, it can be real or imaginary, repeating also, non-repeating also. Next is to understand the difference between the words root and solution. So I want all of you to take a moment and really think that what is the difference between the word root and the word solution. So see, root can repeat, solution can't repeat. This is the difference. Now you must also remember that repetition of root, this concept of repetition of root, is only valid for polynomials. For other graphs and functions, repetition has no effect, no use, no definition also. So let's take an example. So suppose if I say x minus 1 whole square into x minus 2 whole cube is equal to 0, then the roots of this equation are टू 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 वन वन एंड सॉल्यूशंस ऑफ दिस इक्वेशन आर टू एंड वन बिकॉज इन दिस केस वी हैव अ फाइव डिग्री पॉलिनॉमियल सो अ फाइव डिग्री पॉलिनॉमियल मस्ट हैव फाइव रूट्स सिंपली बिकॉज एवरी रूट विल बिकम अ फैक्टर इफ यू टेक अ फाइव डिग्री पॉलिनॉमियल यू शुड बी एबल टू क्रिएट फाइव फैक्टर्स बिकॉज ऑफ फैक्टर थियरम सो इफ देर आर फाइव रूट्स देर शुड बी फाइव फैक्टर्स राइट सो हियर देर आर फाइव फैक्टर्स टू फैक्टर्स आर एक्स माइनस वन थ्री फैक्टर्स आर एक्स माइनस टू राइट यू कैन नॉट डू वन 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 एंड टू टू अकॉर्डिंग टू योर विश नो नंबर ऑफ फैक्टर्स ऑफ एक्स माइनस वन दैट मेनी टाइम्स वन विल रिपीट नंबर ऑफ फैक्टर्स एक्स माइनस टू दैट मेनी टाइम्स टू विल रिपीट सो सेकेंड पॉइंट इज असाइड केप्ट असाइड नाउ लेट्स गो टू थर्ड पॉइंट सो थर्ड पॉइंट अबाउट पॉलिनॉमियल्स सो थर्ड पॉइंट अबाउट पॉलिनॉमियल्स इज लाइक दिस दैट फैक्टराइजेशन दैट इफ अल्फा इज अ रूट ऑफ अ पॉलिनॉमियल then x minus alpha is a factor of same polynomial so fourth point in polynomials is about remainder theorem. So it is said that if a polynomial P of x is divided by x minus alpha, then remainder will be P of alpha. So you can understand it like this. See, suppose P of x is divided. So dividend is equal to divisor into quotient plus remainder. Now remainder has to be a constant. Remainder cannot be a variable simply because you are dividing by a 1 degree polynomial. If you divide by a 1 degree polynomial, you cannot get more than 1 degree or more than 1 degree remainder. So R must be a constant. So divisor, dividend, quotient, remainder, this you know already. In this, just put x equal to alpha. And you will see P of alpha is equal to R. So remainder is equal to the value of polynomial by putting alpha. So it is like this. Suppose you divide fx by x minus 2, then remainder is f2. Now, suppose remainder is 0. So, suppose remainder is 0, then f2 is 0. F2 is 0 means 2 is root. 2 is root means x minus 2 is a factor. See, if remainder is 0 here, if remainder decides to become 0, see x minus alpha decides to become factor or not, fpx becomes equal to x minus alpha into qx. Right? So, it just kind of fits very nicely. Let's go to fifth point. Fifth point is that in case of polynomials with real coefficients, imaginary roots occur in conjugate pairs. Imaginary roots occur in conjugate pairs means we have already established that in while studying quadratic equations. So let us go ahead and make some more conclusions. So see, since imaginary root occur in pairs, so number of imaginary roots is always even. Since number of imaginary roots is always even, for an odd degree polynomial, or why to write for, simply we can say odd degree polynomial has odd number of real roots. So I want you to look at it very sincerely. See, number of imaginary roots is always even. So odd degree polynomial will have odd roots because number of degree is equal to number of roots. So suppose some polynomial is there who is of, let us say, 5 degree, then it must have 5 roots. Now number of imaginary roots cannot be 5. So all roots can't be imaginary. So some roots has to be real. So we can say that odd degree polynomials have at least one real root. So we have tried to cover all the aspects of theory as far as J main preparation is concerned. Let's go to next point. So next point is the concept of repeated roots. So what happens is, okay, so if alpha is a repeated root, repeating, let us say m times, then x minus alpha is a repeated factor repeating m times. So this thing can be theoretically written like this, that p of x will have x minus alpha, x minus alpha, x minus alpha, x minus alpha, m times, like this, and some q of x then. So if this is true, then from here we can obviously say that p of alpha is 0, and then p dash alpha will also be 0, and then p double dash alpha will also be 0, p triple dash alpha will also be 0, and in the same manner if we continue, p of m minus 1 alpha will also be 0. Pm will definitely not be 0 unless we have some more x minus alpha hidden inside qx. So this point is clear. Then we go to next point. So I think that's about it. One more concept is there of the concept of this intermediate value theorem. So okay, let's just discuss that. So intermediate value theorem, use of, let's not do that, it's not from this chapter. So we will just do intermediate value theorem. Application in polynomials. So okay, you can't see this, let me just drag it a little down. Yeah, so use of intermediate value theorem in polynomials. So see, if f of k1 into f of k2 is less than 0, then at least one root of polynomial fx lies between k1 and k2. So how we are saying this, let's just see that. suppose this is k1 and we have k2. Now we are saying f of k1 into f of k2 is negative. So let us take that f of k1 is positive and f of k2 is negative. We're just assuming that. Draw a graph. Now if you start at this point and if you want to end at this point, you cannot go from this point to that point without crossing x-axis. This is the whole idea. So you must cross x-axis. You must cross x-axis means wherever you will cross x-axis, there your root will come. So minimum one root. Now it is not necessary that you should have one root only. You can go crazy like this. Right. So but definitely you cannot have zero real roots between k1 and k2. That is the idea. So this is about it for quadratic equations. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to be a part of your life. And I'm really blessed and privileged in so many ways to have, you know, contributed in some way to your life. I really wish and hope and pray that you do your exam well, and more importantly, you be safe now in these difficult times. I'm sure that all of you are taking the precautions in the correct way, but please do take care. Lot of people depend upon you. Thank you very much.